Let's proceed to the session for which everyone is waiting.
Yes. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. You are completely audible to everyone. Now the floor is yours. Please continue the session.
First of all, apologies. I know I'm late by 7 minutes. Actually, I've been trying on my system, but there is some technical glitch, and that's why I just transferred it to the other lab. Nonetheless, as we all know that today we are going to talk about the check bounce law and what are the legal remedies and what are the legal provisions that can help us. So in the beginning, we need to understand what is the basic, what is the gist through which the check bounce litigation begins. And thereafter, the whole procedure which a person needs to follow. And thereafter, we will also realize and we will also discuss about other remedies. For example, civil law, criminal law remedies, which are not directly related to check bounce. However, the same remedies can be availed through different forums. And of course, a few case laws will be discussed in the meantime. And I request everyone whosoever has any questions regarding any subtopic that we'll be discussing, he or she may put it in the chat box so that Ms. Ishani can bring the relevant question. And of course, in the end, we will be having Q&A session. So now to begin with the basics of a check bounce is that it begins with a legal transaction. For example, there is a seller and there is a buyer. Seller agrees to sell a certain amount, certain quantities of its goods. For example, 10 chairs. So 10 chairs are transferred to the buyer and buyer says that yes, he wants to purchase those 10 chairs. For clarification, let's assume that every chair costs 100 rupees. So 1000 rupees is the bill. But the buyer says that he does not have any liquidity amount at this point of time. However, he can issue the check. Now the check is issued against the transaction. So the beginning of the check related transaction begins with the legal transaction, meaning thereby one thing is transferred to the other party in consideration of something. So in this case, the seller sold certain amount of quantities of shares, that is 10 shares, to the other party in consideration of 1000 rupees. Now that's the first point of check bounce litigation. We all need to understand that whether there is any legal transaction which occurred or not, and legal transaction gives birth to the legal debt. Now legal debt herein lies in favor of seller because he does not get 1000 rupees at that point of time, but at the same point of time he receives the check against the 10 shares. So this is the legal debt. Till the time the check is cleared or till the time the buyer pays through any other medium to the seller, the legal debt still lies. So these two important things which we need to consider while dealing with the check bounce litigation. Now what happens is seller goes to his bank and submits the check and thinking that probably within a day or so he'll have 1000 rupees and he may do something regarding that 1000 rupees. After a couple of days he got a call from his bank and bank informed him that the particular check is not cleared due to accounts closed. Now accounts closed meaning thereby that the buyer has instructed his bank that the check should not be cleared or he has blocked his account so that the check cannot be cleared. Now here the third concept comes in, that the check gets dishonored. Dishonored meaning that the check does not get cleared. In the relevant provision of law, there are certain things that are given. And apart from that, there are various judicial decisions through which various causes are given which may attract 130, which may attract the relevant provision. Here in this case, the accounts close is the reason, and the other reasons could be that the funds are insufficient, the other person has strictly instructed his bank not to clear the check, and there are so many other reasons. For example, as commonly we consider that the signatures don't match, or the particulars mentioned in the check amount are not clear are not in consonance with the reality or the real details of the seller or the buyer maybe. So these are certain things due to which a particular bank does not clear the check. Now the bank will issue the bank memo to the seller. Bank memo meaning that the bank will issue the particular form of certificate to the seller stating that this particular check was given to the bank and the bank did not clear it because of funds insufficient or, as we discussed in this case, accounts closed reason. So the reason is always given in the bank memo. And now after the bank memo, the section 138 or the necessary litigation begins. Now this is the procedure, or this is the basics which gives rise, or which gives which attracts the relevant provision. Now the relevant provision is given in Negotiable Instruments Act, that is section 138 onwards. Section 138 says whenever there is a legal liability that we discussed, and against the legal liability check is issued, and thereafter the check gets bounced, like we discussed in this case, then the seller, the act may talk about the complainant. The complainant is the one who files the complaint, and thereafter the complainant or the seller in this particular case, the seller can initiate the litigation. Now for initiating the litigation, he has 30-day time period after receiving the bank memo from the concerned bank. For let's say example that he received the bank memo on 1st of September 2020. So he has 30 days thereafter. The first of September would not be counted. So the bank memo date needs to be considered. So from 2nd of September till 1st of October, he has those 30 days. In between those 30 days, he needs to send a legal notice to the buyer stating all the necessary things that we'll be discussing after this point of session. The necessary things need to be discussed in legal notice. And after this 30-day, within these 30-day time period, he needs to send a legal notice. That is one requirement. Thereafter, he needs to give 15-day time period to the buyer. And 15-day will be counted when the buyer actually receives the legal notice from the seller. Now, in this case, for example, he received the legal notice on 1st of October itself. So from 2nd of October till 16th of October, the buyer will have those 15 days to reply or to repay the amount, to repay the entire amount. Now, till 16th of October, the complainant, and in this case, the seller, cannot take any action as far as Section 138 of NIA is concerned. Now, after the expiry of those 15 days, if the seller does not get amount, does not get 1,000 rupees from the buyer, then the seller has to file complaint under Section 138 before the concerned magistrate within 30 days after the expiry of that 15-day time period. So it works like that. The seller will always get that we need to follow. And what's interesting and what's important that we need to consider, that in check bounce litigation, all the courts are very stringent about the time limits. In other areas of law, you may still find various judgments where you can see the relaxation or the kind attitude of the judiciary. Whereas in 138 litigation, even one day delay is not acceptable in most of the cases. So you need to consider these details or these timeline limits in order to succeed or in order to file complaint under 138. Now, coming back to Section 138 talks about all this time limit that we just discussed. And it says that the complainant needs to file complaint before the concerned magistrate. Now, the concerned magistrate is the one who has the jurisdiction over the bank which issues the bank memo. Earlier, the accused bank is the concerned bank, but after the amendment, the complainant bank, meaning thereby wherever the seller submits his check for the clearance and the bank which issues the bank memo, that bank will determine the jurisdiction. And the concerned magistrate who has jurisdiction over that particular bank will be the concerned magistrate who needs to take care or who needs to entertain Section 138 litigation thereafter. Now, before I move ahead with what you need to file in a Section 138 complaint or what needs to be done thereafter, we need again, I'll take back to you the basics as to what needs to be stated legal notice, and where does it stand? Where does the NIX stand, and where does the entire check bounce litigation stand? So you may question that it is entirely a civil scenario that the legal transaction happened, thereafter the check was issued and the check did not get cleared. So there is no malafide intention. There could be malafide intention and there could not be malafide intention. So it's a civil law. Why NI Act or why criminal action came into picture. This scenario is correct. However, till 1980s or 1990s, there was no amendment, and this was considered only a civil remedy. But after the concerned amendment, that has brought into the criminal law books in order to discourage the surplus activities by the accused, so that the confidence in the check and in negotiable instrument could be improved in the business market and in the normal commercial transactions. So this is considered as a summons case. Summons case is a case where the punishment is maximum of couple of years. So here in this case, the magistrate can award only punishment up to couple of years or twice of the check amount or both. So it's a summons case under CRPC. We need to take care of that. And that's why the concerned magistrate comes into picture and not the session judge as such. Along with that, in this section 138 litigation, summary procedure is prescribed. Summary procedure is basically slightly different and slightly easier from other summons cases or from other cases which people follow in normal CRPC procedure. The difference causes a slight, I would say, it derails or it cut down the time that a normal court or a normal case usually witnesses when it follows the normal procedure as given in CRPC. But in CRPC, as far as the summary cases are concerned, there are certain procedures or there are certain steps which have been eliminated so that the same can be do away within 6 months or within 12 months as the case may be. However, the endurance or the directions as per NI Act given is 6 months that the concerned magistrate needs to take care or needs to endure in order to complete the entire 138 case within 6 months as such. So this is the basic gist of the criminal law that is applied in section 138 cases. And now coming back to the legal notice, what a person needs to file, what a person needs to take care while drafting legal notice. Now in legal notice, very basic things need to be take care of. First, that whatever the legal transaction happened, whether the what is the nature of the parties, whether the parties are neighbors, whether the parties are known to each other, or whether they are strangers. In practical scenarios, whenever the check is given, mostly parties are aware, unless and only in exigencies there could be some different issues. But nowadays, that people slightly have lost confidence in check amounts, so only with some references, only with some known persons, they derive or they believe upon check. Now, after introducing the parties in general, after telling the entire transaction, what happened, what is the nature of the transaction, which gives birth to legal debt. Now, in legal notice, we need to define the legal transaction which gives birth to legal debt. I'm repeating again about the legal debt because without legal debt, the entire check bounce litigation goes up. For example, if I just give Mr. X a check for no consideration at all, if I write down 1 lakh rupees and tomorrow if it gets bounced, so Mr. X cannot sue me because there is no legal liability and there is no legal transaction in that particular scenario. So that's why legal transaction as well as legal liability needs to be explained in the legal notice. Thereafter, you also need to mention that you have presented the check to your bank and the bank, after scrutinizing it, issued a bank memo stating that the check gets dishonored, and the reason you need to mention that whatever the reason. For example, in this case, the account closed was the reason. So you need to mention it. Now, thereafter, you also need to mention that within 30-day time period, your counsel or if the litigant is in person only, he was able to send the entire notice within 30-day time period as stipulated in 138. Thereafter, you need to give 15-day time period to the other party, that the 15-day time period, statutory time period is given to you. And if you do not adhere to this time limit, then the complainant or your client does have the opportunity to sue you under 138 or under any other law. So this is the gist of the legal notice that you need to mention. In legal notice, there is no need to explain the things. There is no need to you know, highlight other things which are not necessary. The legal notice under under 138 sections, or if I say in every other proceedings, legal notice are very precisely, and it should not adhere, or it should not go here or there, because that may give rise, or that may give some liberty to the buyer, in this case, to pull out certain loopholes or to pull out certain deficiencies in the legal notice, and that can hamper the case itself. So never ever introduce any other fact which is not related to the legal transaction, legal date, and whatever happened between the bank and thereafter the time limit that you have followed there. So this is the gist of the legal notice that you need to follow. Now, as we discussed that from 2nd of October to 16th of October, he does have time to revert. Now, taking example that he did not revert and he is not paying any amount of money to the seller. Now, from 17th of October till 15th of November, the concerned seller has the opportunity to file a complaint under 138 to the concerned magistrate. Now, his counsel has filed, for example, in the last week of October. The complaint before the concerned magistrate. Now, we see the first thing is clear that the entire mechanism is being followed. The entire mechanism is under the time limit. And in the complaint, you basically need to incorporate all the details that you have followed in your 138 notice. Apart from that, you also need to give that 15-day time period was given to the buyer, and despite of the expiry of that 15-day time period, the buyer did not repay you any amount of money. And thereafter, you have the right to file this complaint before this magistrate, and this complaint is filed within 30-day time period also. So these things are need to be mentioned in the complaint. So basically, I would say the complaint is nothing but the stretching point or the advanced form of the legal notice. So a lot of people do mistake as in that they get the legal notice drafted here or there, maybe to avoid certain bugs. But what hampers is that once whatever you have followed or whatever you have incorporated in legal notice under 138, you cannot go here or there, and you have to follow and you have to carry it till the end of the case, till the end of the entire litigation process. So it's extremely important that you follow and that you mention everything that needs to be drafted in 138 notice. Now there is one helpful amendment for all the complainants in 138 cases, and that is section 143A. 143A says that during the litigation process, the court can direct the accused person to give maximum of 20% of the check amount to the complainant, despite the pendency of the case and despite that the end result of the case is still pending. So this, of course, puts a lot of pressure upon the accused, but at the same point of time, it gives a lot of chance for settlement. And it gives a huge relief to the complainant, because complainant has already suffered in terms of the bad legal transaction, and thereafter he is also suffering not only on financial basis but also on other fronts of facing and of on dealing with this legal transaction and legal litigation. So in legal complaint that you can also mention about section 143A of NI Act. So This is the gist of legal notice as well as legal complaint that a person needs to follow while drafting it or while handling it, or in fact while defending it also, that you need to find out whether these procedures have been followed or not. And once again, at the cost of repetition, I'll reiterate that if any of the procedure is not followed, even by a day or even by a couple of days, then there are huge chances that the court will set aside the entire complaint despite there being legitimate legal debt and legitimate legal transaction. So this needs to be considered while taking care of everything. Now, moving ahead, what all documents need to be filed at the time of filing of the complaint? First, that you will have the check, you will file a check. And if you have a transaction, if you have the invoices of that transaction that gives birth to legal debt, you may of course attach those invoices. Suppose if you don't have the invoices, there is no requirement that you had to you had to annex the concerned invoices. After the legal after the check, you need to annex the bank memo. Now, bank memo, there is another one important thing which we need to consider, that in the bank memo, the bank stamp must be there. Suppose if the bank issues the bank memo without its bank stamp, the court during the stage of appreciation of evidence can set aside cannot rely upon the bank memo which is not duly stamped. So once while taking bank memo from the concerned bank, it is always advisable to receive the bank memo with the concerned bank stamp. Now, what recent development a few banks have introduced in their process itself, that they have started generating this bank memo through computer generated or electronically generated tools. So in those bank memo, it is clearly written that there is no need of bank stamp, and there is no need of signatures also. So whenever there is such disclaimer, then of course there is no need of bank memo. But if such disclaimer is not mentioned, then every bank memo must have bank stamp along with the concerned signature, of course. But having said so, it is always advisable that even if a particular bank issues a bank memo with the declaration that it does not require bank stamp, you may request the bank officials to just put it for the sake of clarity and for the removal of all doubts which may arise in future. Now, having said so, there needs to be invoices, check needs to be followed by the bank memo followed by the copy of legal notice, because the original legal notice will be in the possession of the buyer. You will have the copy of the legal notice. You need to attach the copy of legal notice. Thereafter, you also need to file the postal details of the legal notice, meaning thereby that when this notice was sent to the buyer, you will have the postal details, the relevant receipts of from the postal authorities that yes, such and such person has transferred or has posted certain documents to the other person on this date. And when we use that postal details through internet, we will get the entire details as to when this order was dispatched and when this order was received by the other party. So in this thing absolves and saves the excuse of the other party that he did not receive it, because in most, or I would say in almost all the cases, it's almost impossible that whatever is inscribed upon the postal receipt details, that they are not in conformity with the actual delivery of the case. Now thereafter, you may annex the, I would say last couple of years or last 3 years of ITR or bank statements of the buyer, because though it's not necessary, but if the circumstances of the case warrants that the amount is big and you need to show that the buyer has the ability to pay a certain amount of money to the seller, and he can entertain certain kind of transaction on the basis of credit, then this ITR details and bank statements can be very handy. Though there are judgments, it's a settled law that it is not required, but whenever the circumstances warrant, it's always advisable to incorporate all the details. But at the time of filing of the complaint, I would again suggest that the person should not follow. Maybe during the stage of the cross-examination, when this question arises, the complainant can, with the permission of the magistrate, file these documents along with this appropriate application. Now, these all documents need to be filed at the time of filing of complaint under 138. Now, the court will see the three main issues: whether there is a legal debt, whether the check was issued, and whether the check was dishonored because of certain reasons that are permissible. And of course, a few other details need, the court will see that the all mechanism has been followed within the due period of time or not. and whether the complainant has annexed all the relevant details or not. So after seeing, I would say, all these formalities, the court issues notice to the accused person. Now, in Delhi, at least 3 to 4 months, if the case is filed by an individual, but if the case is filed by an enterprise or some company, then it may take 4 to 5 months easily from the next day. So you can imagine that the ordeal complainant needs to take care of first. He needs to follow the, first he needs to take care of this legal notice, and then he need to wait for 1 or 1.5 months, and thereafter, after the notice, he again needs to wait for 4 to 5 months, if not more, or if not less. So this is the time period that a complainant needs to bear, just in order to see the reply from the other party. And more often than not, it happens that on the first date of hearing, the other party does not turn up. So again, it stretches to another 3-4 months. And that's why check bounce litigation, despite the clear intention of the legislature that it needs to be solved within 6 months, the check bounce litigation goes for years and years. And I have my first case was check bounce litigation, and it was a decade old check bounce litigation. And now it's pending in before the Delhi High Court. So you can imagine that the normal check bounce litigation can take 12 to 14 years, but that's really exception. However, in general scenario, 3 to 5 years or 6 years are easily consumed by this check bounce litigation thing. Now, suppose the other party, the buyer, comes up on the next date of hearing. The buyer needs to plead guilty or not guilty, whatever he decides. Of course, he will plead not guilty, that he did not commit any such illegal deed. And now the interesting part in that, at the time of submitting his statement, the court will frame notice under 251 of CRPC. Now 251 of CRPC is of 3 or 4 questions: whether you plead guilty or not guilty, whether you have signed this check or not, or whether there is a legal transaction that the other party has alleged. So at times the accused says yes in a few scenarios and no in a few scenarios. So there can be no straitjacket formula as to what the complainant needs to follow thereafter, because it is entirely depend upon the answer that the other person will give, whether he has signed the check, whether he has filled the check, but he has not signed the check. So there are certain scenarios that we need. That we keep listening and we keep hearing at the time of this check bounce litigation course. Now, after this framing of notice, the complainant now has the opportunity to press for 143A course that we have already discussed. That in the check bounce litigation, the concerned person does have the opportunity to get maximum of 20% of the check amount. Now, after framing of notice, the court can ask the accused person to pay maximum 20% of amount to the complainant. So this thing, though not very widely followed till yet, but it's very advisable and it's very handy when it comes to seek settlement, or when it comes to put certain kind of pressure to the other party. And of course, it also register your case in the mind of the court that yes, there is certain transaction happened, and that's why maybe the accused did not protest or agree to pay certain amount of money to the other party. So it's a very welcome legislation, and it has created a lot of good impact on various cases. And it's equally important that you mention in the complaint, because you don't need to file the separate application for that, because in practicality, that the courts appreciate the written the written application or written form of submission even in 138 cases. So there are a couple of ways. One you mention in 138 complaint, or one you submit application after the framing of notice. But it's always viable, because once you submit the application, the other party will say that he needs certain time to revert to this particular application. But when you file it in the complaint, the other party cannot take this defense, because he has already received the copy of 138 case whence the notice was issued by the court. And thereafter, we come to the appreciation of evidence. Appreciation of evidence meaning hereby that the complainant will go to the witness box, and the opposite party can come and opposite party can cross question related to the take whatever he has stated in 138. This is the only opportunity with the accused counsel or with the accused side to disrupt the entire case. Because what is peculiar in 138 litigation is section 139 of NIA. Section 139 says that the legal onus to prove the case lies upon the shoulders of the accused and not upon the complainant. In normal civil and normal criminal cases, it is always the complainant who needs to prove the case. But in 138 cases, by the virtue of section 139, the onus lies on the shoulder of the accused person. So here the accused person is not entitled to file any written reply. The accused person does not have a opportunity to submit his version in detail as such. However, he has the opportunity to dismantle the case of the other party with the help of this cross-examination. So I can say if there is any opportunity to go away from this case, it is the cross-examination of the complainant and nothing else. Now, in the cross-examination, the basic, and I again repeat that the legal mechanism and all the details that we had already discussed need to be discussed. And whenever there is any discrepancy, the same can be highlighted in the cross-examination, and that can prove and that can actually dismantle the case of the complainant. Now, having said so, the accused counsel can come up and say that the complainant does not have the financial balance or the financial security to honor this kind of transaction. So in cross-examination, those questions must be asked which are relevant to the practical scenarios, but those are not mentioned and those are not highlighted under 138. For example, if the complainant does not have financial means to honor that particular legal transaction that he has talked about, then of course, it's very difficult for the court to believe upon the words of the complainant. Suppose if taking the other example, there is a friendly loan given by Mr. A to Miss B. Now Miss B comes up and say and proves in the cross examination that Mr. A is already insolvent and he does not have means to pay to sustain his own life, and forget about what he can deliver to the other party in form of loan or in form of anything else. So in cross examination, those practical things need to be entertained. Thereafter, the complainant does have the opportunity to bring more witnesses into the box, maybe formal witnesses like the concerned official from the postal department, the concerned official from both the banks. And if the same is filed by POA or if the transaction happens in front of somebody, the concerned person may be asked in the witness box. So this is the opportunity that the complainant has. Whereas after this, the accused has one opportunity to come forward and to face the cross-questioning from the complainant's counsel. Now, once again, this is again important, because if the complainant's counsel does not ask the relevant questions and does not affirm what he has already stated in the complaint, then again, the court will have the reasonable suspicion that the complainant does not provide or does not come up with the requisite data or requisite things that he need to come up with despite having section 139. So the responsibility of the complainant side is slightly less as compared to the responsibility of the accused counsel while cross-examining the other party. But if the cross-examination of the complainant has dismantled the case of the complainant itself, then again it is once again the opportunity of the complainant side to bring certain lacunas in the defense of the accused, that he can actually highlight his case. And what's important while cross-examining the accused is the usage of section 139. That in cross-examination of the accused, complainant does not need to go into the details. He just needs to highlight the relevant provision that certain transaction happened and certain things happened. Apart from that, there is no need to go into the details. Provided that the previous course of hearings and the previous litigation parts have been entertained or have been followed in the manner that needs to be followed up. And thereafter, the court hears the final arguments after all the evidences. And these days, from the past few years, courts have followed up with the tendency that they invite written submissions from both the parties. A written submission is nothing that... written statements. So written statement is nothing but the I would say the gist from both the ends regarding whatever happened and why this case needs to be answered in their favor. Basically, it's the summary of their own case and of their own defenses. So it again gave the opportunity to the counsel and to the parties to come up and to highlight the issues that they could not do so or they have done so and they wanted to reiterate. But this is only at the discretion of the concerned magistrate, whether magistrate wants WS or not. The second, the concerned magistrate is not bound by it. But I would strongly suggest that despite of the strength and despite of the weakness of your case, it is always advisable to submit the to at least request for the for this WS, because tomorrow if the court decides otherwise, despite the strength of your case, you will have something to prove in the appellate court that you have submitted and you have already highlighted prior to the pronouncement of the order. So every time and in every case, you may see that the court does not go ahead with what you may presume or what normal tendency or in normal scenarios may come up, because at the end, it's a matter of interpretation and the court may interpret what you have, what you think that may not be relevant. So it's always important that you at least press, and if it's denied, it's denied, but you should not miss the opportunity to submit written submission. And more in my experience, the courts always welcome it because it helps them at it eases the process of them to go through the entire case, and you could just highlight or you could just point out the relevant pages of cross-examination and certain judgments that you would like to rely upon. That actually makes the job of the court easier, and that's what the particular counsel or all counsel must do to make the job easier, and to of course to assist the court in the best possible manner. Now, having said so, we'll just discuss about a couple of appellate provisions, and thereafter we will be discussing about 2-3 case laws, and of course there are certain other remedies that we discussed in the beginning, and if any of the audiences has questions he or she may ask even during the session or at the end of the session as he or she may like. Now moving ahead with the appellate thing, Mr. Shani, if you come across with any question or if you think that anything needs to be asked, then we can discuss it along with that, because almost the entire procedure of 138 is being covered up and I'm just going into the advanced stages of this case.
Yeah, I will rather request to all the participants that if they have any question, then they can ask the question in the chat box, and even if they want to ask directly, then I will unmute them.
Moving ahead with the appellate provisions, that the appellate provision is I have received one question regarding the return memo. Shani,
regarding the memo,
could you please just reiterate the question? I can't read it in my am I audible, Mr. Shani?
Yeah, the memo need to have complete the customer name and the account number, the return memo. Is it necessary to have the customer name and the account number on the return memo?
It basically depends upon the practice followed by the bank. What is important is that the concerned check number is given, and the account details of the customer needs to be given. Only then the court can rely that yes, it is the bank account of the complainant only. And as we discussed, that the bank memo must have the stamp of the concerned bank. So these details must be there, and of course the reason why this check was bounced. So these are the important details. However, in few bank memos I have witnessed that only 3 lines are given, and in a few private banks I have seen that huge, I would say, a very detailed form of bank memo is provided even in 138 cases. So it's basically policy to policy, but these things need to be considered, that the check details are there and at least name or the account number of the complainant needs to be there in order to highlight and in order to justify that yes, this is the account being maintained by the concerned person. Having said so, if the complainant has any doubts regarding the particulars of the bank memo, in the cross-examination part, he can ask and he can call the concerned bank official, and he can justify and he can prove that yes, this is the bank memo given on the basis of the dishonored object or because of such and such reason. So due to this cross-examination provision, certain lagunas can be covered up thereafter. So this is again one opportunity then that complainant can utilize. Now moving ahead, that we were talking about the appellate provision. So one difference that we need to consider in the appellate provision is that suppose if the complainant wins the case, then the accused person has the right to file an appeal before the session court itself. Whereas if the complainant loses the case and if the court acquits the accused person, then the complainant does not have any opportunity to file an appeal before the session court. He needs to file the revision petition before the high court only. As we discussed in my personal experience, there was a decade-old case, the complainant lost the case. So he has filed a revision before the concerned magistrate, before the concerned high court. So this is the striking difference that you need to entertain, because at times what happens that complainant, despite losing the case, files the case before the session court, and session court at times admits the case, and only at the end or only in the middle of the entire litigation, the session court decides that the session court does not have power, and the entire the effort of the complainant goes in vain, and then of course he needs to follow the case before the high court. And high court, of course, as we all know, that high court takes few years to decide it. And be it session court, be it high court, they do not appreciate the evidence at length as we do in magistrate court. What we need to consider either in session court or either in high court is that what are the lacunas that the magistrate has missed, and whether all the necessary things have been followed. And if you are from the complainant side, make sure that you hamper upon section 139, that the court, that the magistrate does not follow the mandate of section 139. Whereas if you are following, if you are on the lines of the accused person, then you may highlight that the certain mechanism or the proper mechanism was not followed, and thereafter the case was deserved to be set aside. So this is a basic of the appeal provision that a particular person needs to take care of. And thereafter we come to the point of three judgments. I would say those are really important. The first is C.C. Alavi versus P. Mohammed. It's a Supreme Court judgment. It says that even if the accused person does not receive notice, the legal notice that we talked about at the beginning of the complaint, even if he does not receive legal notice, but if he receives the summons from the court, and if he comes up to the court, he cannot take the defense that he did not receive the legal notice. What the court can do, court can provide the similar 15-day period to the concerned accused person after receiving the notice and summons from the court. And again, the accused person has the opportunity to settle the case within those 15-day period. So one of the common defenses that the accused side come up with, that they did not receive any legal notice from the complainant side. But C.C. Alavi judgment has do away with this thing also. And at times it happens that the accused person issues the check and goes away. And after a long time, they come back. So in the middle of that, the entire check bounce litigation time period goes away. So in order to take care of all these cheap tricks by the accused side, this judgment is always helpful. And whenever the magistrate asks whether there is a proper delivery of a legal notice or not, and if there is any doubt, then this judgment can be relied upon. So this is C.C. Alavi versus P. Mohammed Supreme Court judgment. The second judgment I could refer to is the, I would say, K.N. Nath. It says that it basically reiterates section 139 only. It's K.K. Mina. It's K.K. Mina judgment. It's a very old judgment. Supreme Court, I guess 2010 or 2011, if I'm not mistaken. It says that the accused side has the liability to prove that the case does not lie against him, and the accused side needs to come up with some strong statement and strong defense. Merely simple denial is not enough in order to rebut the presumption given in section 139. So it's always we may use this judgment even when the other party says that he has managed to dislodge the presumption given in 139. So this judgment is very helpful. It has followed up in various cases, But it's still very helpful, and it's just a couple of page judgment. So it's actually very handy when it comes to any kind of 138 litigation. And the last judgment, which I think I need to talk about, is the state was court on its own motion versus state. It's a case pending before Delhi High Court. Now it's a very interesting case where the court is baffled with one scenario, and that is whether at the time of framing of notice, the court can discharge the accused person or not. Because in CRPC, the magistrate can discharge the person in warrants cases. The session court can discharge the accused person at the time of warrant cases. But in summons cases, when the summons case is being heard by magistrate, the CRPC does not give specific power to magistrate. And in various cases, in Adalat Prasad judgment of Supreme Court and various Supreme Court judgments and various High Court judgments, it has been clarified that the magistrate does not have power to discharge the accused person in 138 cases because CRPC does not explicitly provide so. But despite of that, the court is now being referred with this question among others, and the case is still pending. Now it would be very interesting to see whether the court will follow the settled law or the court will turn up the wheel and may provide some justice to the accused person. I think that the court should reconsider this thing, because the innocent accused person does not have any opportunity. He needs to face the entire case, or he has one remedy, that is 482 before the High Court. And High Court under 482 are very cautious while quashing away any case. So if you remove the provision of discharge at the time of framing of notice, it gives no right and no liberty to the innocent person, especially when you are dealing with Section 139, such stringent case, such stringent provision. So I think it would be in the interest of justice and equity that the Honorable Delhi High Court will reconsider this issue and may provide some relief to the accused person. Now, having said so, last we will be dealing with
also have an question that.
Yeah, please.
Is there any changes in the litigation process due to the CTS clearing system of the check, CTS check clearing system?
Due to check clearing system, what? Is there any proof?
CTS check clearing system, yes. Is there any changes in the litigation process?
Is there a change in litigation process?
Yeah.
Okay. See, it depends upon the future course of action, whether the scheme will cause any benefit or whether the scheme will change anything. However, one other statute that is not usually followed, that is PSS Act, Payment Settlement System Act. It basically it deals with a lot of things, but it also comes up with the electronic transactions. Not per se NEFT or NTGS, but at the same point of time, there are certain transactions which are in consonance with the check payment transaction. And once those transactions get bounced, it takes in the form of 138 litigation. So I think on these lines, the CDS may not cause any change. However, there are a couple of developments which may cause a lot of change. And that is, the first is the decriminalization of the check bounce litigation that the central government is still considering whether this check bounce litigation should be decriminalized or not. Meaning thereby that the court will once again remove the check bounce litigation from the criminal law books and will make it a civil wrong. I think that it's not a very, appreciable thing, because it removes the fear from the accused side that he or she will not be imprisoned despite of the dishonored check. And there are a lot of voices that have been raised and a lot of organizations have raised their apprehensions regarding the decriminalization of check. And the second thing that the RBI has come up with one thing, that they will now issue the check, or they will now direct the concerned banks to issue the check with one more column, and that is what is the purpose of the transaction. So this will improve and this will highlight the legal mechanism dealing with check bounce, whereas the accused side will again have to face a lot of problem because if he highlights and if he mentions the legal transaction and the needs and why the check was given, then it's very difficult again to rebut it. Again, it's a welcome step for the complainant side. But at the same point of time, as if I consider the innocent accused person, because in partnership, especially in partnership and family related agreements, there are a lot of chances and there is a huge scope that a concerned person can get the signature of the other party without his or her consent or due to one way or the other. And in such scenarios, if the other, if the accused person does not have any opportunity to get away from the case, then I think it's very difficult for him or her to even to defend the case fairly. And now, and for these lines, I think that the Delhi High Court may should consider this thing and may provide certain kind of relaxation to the accused side and give power to the magistrate to discharge the accused person at the same time. Now, just couple of things regarding the other litigations or other provisions that a person can follow. First, yeah, of course, that the criminal...
Can we take one more question, please?
Yes.
In what circumstances check bounce does not amount to an offence?
Does not amount to an offence. As I said, that if there is no legal debt, it won't amount to 138 litigation. If the other party cannot prove that there is any legal liability or legal debt, then there is no, liability. And as far as I think, almost every kind or every possible kind of dishonor is being covered through various judgments. For example, if your match handwriting don't match, if your signatures don't match, if you provide incorrect details, then all these things come up. But if the bank does not issue bank memo, or if the bank says that the concerned bank is not cleared, merely on the basis of, I would say, some irregularities, wrong mentioning of date, and if the check gets expired, because nowadays the check's validity is just of 3 months. So if you present the check after 3 months, it will not attract 138 because that needs to be filed within the validity time period of the check. So this is something that a person needs to follow. And of course, need to take care while submitting the check. Now towards the last scenario from my end, and that is the other parts of law that a person needs to follow. Of course, in criminal side, if I talk about whether 138 case is pending or not, despite of that, he or she can file a complaint before the concerned police station regarding the fraud and regarding other things that may follow, that is breach of trust or misrepresentation, as the case may be. And he or she can simultaneously take the recourse of criminal law. So at one point, 138 litigation is going, and at the same point, the criminal litigation is also going on. So this is the second scenario that a person can take care of. And the third is civil remedy. The civil remedy, of course, can be taken care of. That is Order 37 of CBC. It talks about summary proceedings. So a check bounce related transaction gives to summary proceedings, and a normal recovery suit can be filed under Order 37. And of course, as I said, that it does not depend whether you have initiated 138 litigation or not. All these three litigations can be simultaneously proceeded with because of settled law, and because that in criminal law you are seeking justice, in that is punishment to the other party. The 138 is basically the specific thing that you have, and in civil cases you are seeking merely recovery. So in many cases it is settled that these litigations can be proceeded simultaneously. At the same point of time, now if you misses the time period of this check bounce litigation due to one way or the other, or if your check gets expired, then of course you have these two remedies, that is civil remedy and criminal remedy, to take care of. And these two, despite of 138 litigation, these two things can be taken care of. And of course, I think that we have covered most of the things related to 138. Of course, the drafting part will take a lot of time, and of course, cross-examination, it's a different subject altogether, and probably that cannot be done away in just one session. So now, Mr. Sani, over to you.
Thank you, sir, for this informative session. And also, I want to share this information from all the participants, that they can even take the course that is by the legal thurs and instructed by the Lalit sir on the check bounce litigation and also covering all the aspects of cross examination and the legal drafting. So can I share this screen with all the participants so that they can learn how they can take the course? This is the link that I also shared in our chat box. You can directly learn about the course from the source here. Also, I want to share the course syllabus with the students. That is, first we are covering the introduction and the meaning and importance of the NIAC, and then the mechanism of check bounce cross examination in section 138 cases, and also we have a doubt clearing session where all the students and participants can clear their all the doubts, and the drafting of negotiable instruments and judgments, which are the essence of the law. We have covered all the 12 judgments and also the doubt clearance session too, and amendments and limitations of the act, alternatives of check bounce litigation, and recent cases trends followed by the Indian courts and the career aspects, and then a course completion test. And the course will have 30 video lectures and the downloadable procedures, and also there are so many things. I think now all for the session for the today, and thank you sir for joining us, and it's a very informative session.
Yeah, it's fine.
Thank you all the participants too.
If somebody has question, he or she may can easily contact legal thirst. Thank you Ashani for